So here we are, many updates after the game has launched, and boy has it changed so much over the years in mechanics and the gameplay. So my goal in this video is to let you guys know which I feel are the best bases in State of Decay 2 on every single map. And if you're new here, subscribe for future in-depth guides like this one on State of Decay 2 and the upcoming State of Decay 3. Also, thumbs up so we can find more survivors out there. But we're going to start this off with Meager Valley and the Squilonis Brewing Company, located at the heart of the map with a cost of 750 for the green zone and 1500 in lethal. Now this is a base that comes with 5 small slots that you can build in and 2 large slots you can use as well. One large slot starts off as a staging area, but you can clear and make use for it for whatever you want. It also comes in with a built-in water tank and unique buildings, one of which is the stills, and then you have a tasting room. The downsides are you will need to make room for beds, especially if you have a big community. But obviously the biggest thing that makes this the best base in Meager Valley, or one of the best ones, is the absolute unique buildings this thing has, and it's some of my favorite in the game. And since it is a brewing base, you can make your own beer and do what you want with it. You can sell it for extra influence, which is invaluable, but not only your own beer, you can make your own fuel from the food or ethanol, which is used for crafting. Then you can take that beer you make and then go to the tasting room, and this is a unique room. It acts as both a kitchen and a lounge all in one. All of this increases morale. You can use the beer you make to give a boost to morale or make Molotovs, or again, like I said, sell it, guys. So this is a special room, and it has that 2-in-1 with the kitchen and morale booster like a lounge, so it's massive in my opinion, especially for the higher difficulty runs or even lower difficulties, because all the stills in the tasting room really give that passive morale bonus, which really helps you level up your abilities faster. It also keeps people from leaving your community and generally makes everyone happy, so the Brewing Company takes one of my top spots for Meager Valley for both the mid and end game purposes, and I think this is one of the top 3 favorite bases in the entire game because of how unique it is and all the special bonuses you get. Oh, and it doesn't hurt that it's located pretty much in the middle of the map for easy access to everything. So Whitney Field is classified as an endgame base without a doubt, costing 1750 in the green zone or 3500 for lethal. 8 people are needed, and it comes in with a built-in beds when you first get it, but you can dismantle them, and essentially you have 5 small slots to build in and 3 large slots to play with. Definitely the biggest base in Meager Valley. It also features 2 built-in guard towers, but outside of it being unique, since it is a baseball field, this really is just mostly a large base except one big thing. It features this unique built-in announcer box that does this thing when you turn it on, it triggers a horde siege. Now, you might think, why would I want to trigger horde sieges? Well, 2 reasons. You can farm influence every time you beat it, and you get 200 influence. You can then increase your standing with someone in the community as well, so it's a 2-parter. Now, if you keep your threat pretty down, which isn't too hard to do because you have the 2 guard towers, you can really farm this on a loop and have as much influence as you want. Not only that, you can level up skills while defending the base. It's a little risky, but it definitely stands out, and this takes one of the top spots on the list just because of the sheer size and the unique properties it features. So moving on to the newest map in Trumbull Valley, and we're going to start this off with Farmland Compound. Probably takes the cake for the best base on Trumbull Valley itself for a wide variety of reasons, but it does come with a high cost of 1750 in the green, 3500 in lethal. But despite that cost, the benefits of this base are pretty massive. It comes in with 4 large slots to build anything you want, 3 small slots you can play with for a total of 7 buildable slots that you can really build any sort of base you pretty much dreamed of, especially considering that it comes in with a built-in infirmary and a kitchen as well. Beds also, guys, so I feel safe to say this base is one of the most customizable in the game. As for special perks, it really only has this grill stuff up in the kitchen, which just recently got buffed, but really nothing too crazy. And guys, when it comes to this base, really nothing to complain about either. Probably the biggest advantage this base does have in Trumbull Valley is the fact that it's in the middle of the map, and it makes it easier to access anything you want to accomplish on the map. As for really the one downside, I'd say, is perhaps defending the base can be a little tricky, as there's multiple points Zed's bugs can enter, but with some careful planning and blocking, you can mitigate that pretty much easily. So all in all, I think Farmland Compound is your absolute best base in Trumbull Valley, and I think it's one of the better ones in the entire game. So when I first saw Pterodactyl Tark, essentially a trailer park, I didn't think much of it, but under the surface, I feel as though this might be the very best early starter base in the entire game. With the very low cost of 250 in the green zone and 500 in lethal, this base comes packing with tons of room to build, especially for a base such early in the game. Featuring 5 small slots and 1 large slot, you can really customize and play around quite a bit with the layout. Then you factor in the built-in trailer park beds that give you 4 in total, then a built-in latrine that gives you a plus 10 to morale with the ability to clean the toilets for another 10. This really makes for an awesome lethal run base. The placement of this base is also not too bad, with it being in the northern part of the map with connecting to a main road. Really, the only downside is, again, maybe defending this, as this can be a little tricky, but again, really good placement of blocking off the exits can make a big difference, and this base is easily one of my personal favorite if you're just starting off completely with a new community and need to get into something right away with a lot of options. So Providence Ridge has some of the most interesting bases in the entire game, and because of that, it was a little harder for me to judge with just 2 clear-cut winners. So I actually have 3, and depending on your situation, you're going to want to decide for yourself what fits best. So we'll start this off with my favorite base in the entire map, and that is the Fortified Truck Stop, and that might surprise some of you, but this is what you would consider a mid-game base, costing 500 in the green zone and 1000 in lethal. The reason this is my favorite base on this map is because now I've done 2 full lethal runs, and I go from the starter base to this one, and I never leave anywhere else, including the other endgame bases I'll talk about here shortly. The reason is that this base is just insanely good on all fronts. Comes in with 2 large slots, with an already built-in auto shop that you can tear down if you don't want it, 4 customizable small slots. It also comes in with a built-in kitchen and built-in watchtower, plus an extra fuel tank for the ability to hoard a bunch of fuel rucksacks. So essentially, that's kind of the bonus to this base, is that facility that double downs as a fuel storage and a watchtower at the same time. But what also makes this base great is the actual position of it on this map, and it's located at the top center, but there is really roads that lead to all 4 corners starting from this base. I find typically that 2 large slots is enough for me in the end game, and 4 small slots are definitely good enough, and it really leaves enough wiggle room to build a fighting gym and all the other things that I like to do. But the downside has to be the fact that this is a mid-game base. Beds are going to be very hard to build and come by, and if you end up with a large community of 8 to 10 person, I think you will outgrow this. But one last thing to say is that defending it isn't too bad either, and overall, this is my favorite home on this entire map. So Prescott Fire Station is almost like the Swiss Army knife of an endgame base, and this is one of 2 endgame bases on this map, coming in at 1750 in the green zone and 3500 in lethal, featuring 3 small slots that you can build in, 2 large slots that are free to play with. On the surface, you'll go, man, that's not a lot for an endgame base, but what makes this base interesting is all the built-in things it comes with, starting with a unique utility room that provides both water and power, power at the cost of 2 fuel. So if you happen to not have the legacy boon that gives you the free base-wide power and free base-wide water, this is actually pretty huge. Then it comes in with a built-in watchtower, a built-in fighting gym, which FYI, again, is one of my favorite facilities to build in this entire game because of that free plus 20 health and that fighting experience. It also comes in with a built-in kitchen, a built-in workshop, and a built-in latrine to improve morale, and finally comes in with some beds as well. So obviously, you're getting a lot of your basic needs met, plus a ton of extra goodies. So it's easy to see why this is one of the favorite among many, but mostly if you don't care about the lack of large slots to build in. The base isn't too bad to defend, but the major drawback for me is actually, I think, the location. Being on the bottom left of the map in a town that isn't the easiest to drive through as well is a little annoying, but overall it's a great base and one I do recommend for the endgame. And finally, we have Lumber Mill in Providence Ridge, coming in at the cost of 1750 in the green or 3500 in lethal, classifying it as an endgame base on the map, and that's with a good reason. It has 5 large slots to play with and 3 small slots to build upon. So this is a base that lets you pretty much lay it out in the way that you want. It does feature one special perk, which is the sawmill, that for the cost of labor gets you some free building materials. Unfortunately, building materials, though, will eventually become useless the further along in your playthrough, so it's not that great of a perk. Overall, this base is essentially a blank canvas, and it's why it's on the top of the list, because you can customize it to your liking. It's also not in the very best location, at the very bottom right of the map, and defending it can be a pain, but overall, I really think this is a solid base, especially if you happen to have a very large community. So Drucker County is my favorite map in this entire game, and one reason that is because of the awesome bases it has. Now, I only use two bases every time I'm here. The first one is Mike's Concrete. This is a mid-game base coming in at the cost of 1750 in the green or 1500 in lethal, and it has enough slots to really get the most things that you need. I'd even go as far as saying you can complete a legacy with just this base, featuring 5 small slots that you can build anything with and 2 large slots that are open as well. It even has a built-in machine shop, and the 2 special perks to this base are actually the backup generator, so you don't have to use an outpost for electricity, and then it has this huge fuel storage that gives you a +100. It's also located in a good spot on the map where you can reach anything and reach there at a normal time, so it's positioned well. 2 potential downsides to this though is the fact that you do need to recruit 6 people. I wish that maybe it was around 5, because it does take time to build to that from a fresh community, and the fact that you can have some issues defending this, and you can get hit by Zeds coming from the mountain behind the base. But again, this base comes with 5 small slots to build in and 2 large ones, so really you're getting a lot of bang for your buck at such a low cost of influence. But that's going to bring us to my absolute favorite base in the entire game, and it's here in Drucker County in the Barricaded Strip Mall. And make no mistake, this is an endgame base that is costly to get into, with the 1750 price in the green, 3500 for lethal, and you need 8 survivors, so that's quite a bit. But what makes this so special? All the built-in stuff it comes with, and the fact that it just feels so large. The layout is really nice. To start, it has 3 large open slots for you to play with, as well as 4 small slots that you can build anything with, so that's a total of 7. But the magic is actually all the built-in stuff on top of all the open stuff, and it comes in with a level 2 fitness gym that gives you passive health and an XP boost on cardio, which I always build in my lethal runs because of the added HP is so huge. But this base already comes in with it built in, and then another built in level 3 infirmary, guys, so you don't gotta worry about building that. A level 2 kitchen, which is a nice bonus, a built in latrine for extra morale, which is very critical to a lethal playthrough. So as you guys can see, there is so much you can do here. It's just literally a customizable playground. There is some huge downsides though, maybe 2 downsides. One, the location is god awful on Drucker County, and I find myself having to drive a lot, which really sucks. 2, only 3 parking slots, which really is kind of annoying for such an endgame base, but overall, defending it, guys, is a breeze, and you can set up a watchtower, which I typically do. You can climb the roof as well for some extra immersion. I really feel like this base has it all, from the aesthetics to all the customizable things that you can do. There's just lots of options and all the built-in stuff, so guys, don't play Drucker County and not get into the mall. It's one of the best bases in the entire game. All right, we're moving on to Cascade Hills, and this was a struggle to find 2 bases that were good. One is really solid and makes the list without a doubt, but the rest of the bases have major faults, and it's a lot of average to mostly below average. So we're going to start this off after a lot of evaluation on my end, with our first base being the corner office in Cascade Hills. Ultimately, I came to this conclusion for a few reasons. It only takes 5 people. It costs low with 500 influence in the green zone and 1000 for lethal. It's in the very middle of the map for quick access to everything, which is probably the biggest reason it actually edges out some of the other below average bases. It does have some utility. It has a built-in watchtower, which is useful in higher difficulties. It also has a built-in kitchen. It features 5 open slots that you can build with, and only 1 large slot though is a little limited, but at least it's something there. And the 5 slots really does give you some sort of customization with this, and the fact that it has some decent built-in stuff, and again, the fact that it's in the middle of the map, which is really good for Cascade Hills. So, and probably the last thing that I want to mention is that it's, I think, one of the easiest to defend in the whole game. It has only 4 entrances that Zeds can get into, but you can easily block these with cars, and with the watchtower picking the Zeds off, it's really solid in that defense. department. Honorable mentions do go to quite a few of these other maps, though. If you need more slots for a mid-game base, the More and More Distributing and the Lock and Keo Storage are also good choices, but they are on such terrible spots on the map. That is why they didn't make this list. And then Bridge Fort makes for, I think, a really good early game base, and it almost actually made this list. I'd say it's number three on here if I had to choose a third one. But guys, there is one that's clearly really good for Cascade Hills. This is an amazing base. It's really special, but has one big flaw, maybe two depending on your preference. That is the Container Fort, which is absolutely an endgame base. One of the best in Cascade Hills by miles, costing 1750 in the green and 3500 in lethal. And it comes with something that is pretty amazing that not many bases have, or any at all have. That is built-in beds that don't take up any slots whatsoever. It's kind of almost hidden. So 10 beds in total are already built in, which is huge. And it makes this technically one of the best late game bases in State of Decay 2. It also features a built-in fire safe storage, so you have plenty of room for that, but only two large slots. So that's a little bit weak in that department, but six buildable open small slots. You really have a pretty big blank canvas. The downside of this base, and it might not be a huge deal for some, for me though it mattered. It's why I actually had trouble enjoying myself, and that is the placement of it. You're going to be doing a lot of driving being at the bottom left of Cascade Hills. Also, the layout of this base as well, containers like the name suggests, it's actually kind of hard to get around to the facilities. If you build your infirmary like a dummy like I did at the very top, well, if you're in an emergency situation, it's going to suck to try to go ahead and get yourself all the way to the top, climb a ladder, and keep yourself alive. So you actually have to plan out where you put your buildings and try to learn how to navigate what feels like at times like a maze. So both the location and the layout of the Container Fort made me kind of hate it, but I know it's one of the best bases in the entire game by default and loved by a ton of people. The 10 beds though are a huge difference maker, to say the least. With that, guys, there was a ton of decent bases in State of Decay 2 that almost made my list in this video. Let me know which ones you guys like that I left off so we can help our fellow survivors make good decisions. Hopefully this guide helped in some way. Thumbs up if it did. Also subscribe for future guides like this. I'm Sunny, and as always, stay safe out there, survivors.